Jesus, worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. And then through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life. Amen. Let us join in singing hymn 576, We All Are One in Mission. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you have placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread of heaven and share this bread with all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
The first reading is from Genesis, the 39th chapter, beginning with the first verse. After Joseph had been taken to Egypt by the Ishmaelites, Potiphar, an Egyptian, one of Pharaoh's officials and the manager of his household, brought him from them. As it turned out, God was with Joseph, and things went very well with him. He ended up living in the home of his Egyptian master. His master recognized that God was with him, saw that God was working for good in everything he did. He became very fond of Joseph and made him his personal aide. He put him in charge of all his personal affairs, turning everything over to him. From that moment on, God blessed the home of the Egyptian, all because of Joseph. The blessing of God spread over everything he owned, at home and in the fields, and all Potiphar had to concern himself with was eating three meals a day. Joseph was a strikingly handsome man. As time went on, his master's wife became infatuated with Joseph and one day said, "Sleep with me." He wouldn't do it. He said to his master's wife, "Look, with me here, my master doesn't give a second thought to anything that goes on here. He's put me in charge of everything he owns. He treats me as an equal. The only thing he hasn't turned over to me is you. You're his wife, after all. How could I violate his trust and sin against God?" She pestered him day after day after day, but he stood his ground. He refused to go to bed with her. On one of those days, he came to the house to do his work, and none of the household servants happened to be there. She grabbed him by the cloak, saying, "Sleep with me." He left his coat in her hand and ran out of the house. When she realized that he had left his coat in her hand and ran outside, she called to her house servants, "Look, this Hebrew shows up, and before you know it, he's trying to seduce us. He tried to make love to me, but I yelled as loud as I could. With all my yelling and screaming, he left his coat beside me here and ran outside." She kept his coat right there until his master came home. She told him the same story. She said, "The Hebrew slave, the one you brought to us, came after me and tried to use me for his plaything. When I yelled and screamed, he left his coat with me and ran outside." When his master heard his wife's story, telling him, "These are the things your slave did to me," he was furious. Joseph's master took him and threw him into the jail where the king's prisoners were locked up. But there in jail, God was still with Joseph. He reached out in kindness to him. He put him on good terms with the head jailer. The head jailer put Joseph in charge of all the prisoners. He ended up managing the whole operation. The head jailer gave Joseph free rein, never even checked on him, because God was with him. Whatever he did, God made sure it worked out for the best. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 5th chapter, beginning with the 13th verse. Glory to you, O Lord. Let me tell you why you are here. You're here to be salt seasoning that brings out the God flavors of this earth. If you lose your saltiness, how will people taste godliness? You've lost your usefulness and will end up in the garbage. Here's another way to put it. You're here to be light, bringing out the God colors in the world. God is not a secret to be kept. We're going public with this, as public as a city on a hill. If I make you light bearers, you don't think I'm going to hide you under a bucket, do you? I'm putting you on a light stand. Now that I've put you there on a hilltop, on a light stand, shine. Keep open house, be generous with your lives. By opening up to others, you'll prompt people to open up with God, this generous Father in heaven. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated.
So now we have the children's sermon. Okay, where did Lori go? Oh, there. Okay, I'll come to... Jason, you want to... Can you bring that up? Thank you so much. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay. All right, I always get a little nervous with this, wondering what is going to be in here. Ah. Now this isn't just any rolling pin. This is for making lefse. Now, do you know what lefse is? This is a Swedish church. But we come from the Norwegians. And the Norwegians have, it's kind of like the Norwegian version of a tortilla. Only it's, I think it's better. And you can use it for sweet by putting butter and sugar on. That's what I did as a kid, still do as an adult. Or my father-in-law used to eat it with meat, so savory. But I think about making lefse is out of flour and potatoes. Lori's got a great recipe for lard in it. And it takes a lot of preparation. But part of that then is you put it into little balls and then you roll it out. And you're thinking, okay, how is she going to make this about Jesus? I don't know. I know that in the Bible it talks about when we go through tough times and being tested like silver. And there are times when you feel like you are under the, you know, and being worn thin. And that's what the story about Joseph is about today, is you feel beaten down, rolled out, but God can take those times, those horrible times, and can have something good come out of it. Not that you want to have those horrible times happen, but God is with us. Even when we feel beaten down and rolled out by the corrugated rolling pin. But after all that work and all that effort, the lefse, it's good. That was really stretching it. Lori, you got me on this one. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, you have called us in the midst of times when things are good, but also when things are bad, and we feel under pressure and stretched thin. We ask that you would continue to bring your presence, to bring your mercy. Help us, Lord, to see your blessings that come to us each day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you. Lori does have a really good lefse recipe, and we'll probably start making lefse again. It started in November, so if you want to pass that down. Who would like? Oh, Corey, okay. That sounds, okay, she's got a good one for me. That makes me nervous, but, okay, excellent, thank you. Let us pray. Prepare our hearts, Lord, to receive your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, so that by hearing we may believe, and by believing we may obey your will. Revealed to us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Joseph. Okay. God says, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And we know that Jacob wrestled with God, and God said, okay, your name is no longer going to be the supplanter, the deceiver. It's going to be Israel, for you have striven with God. So we've got the God of Abraham, who had Isaac, who had Jacob / Israel, who then became quite prolific, and had 12 sons and a daughter. And the 11th son number 11, was his favorite. By far, Joseph was the golden boy, because Rachel, his true love, was his mother, and he spoiled Joseph. He made him a coat, which of course his brothers were jealous, because this coat meant it had long sleeves, it was a long dress, tunic, and he didn't have to work herding sheep. And then his brothers were jealous. But Joseph kind of set himself up, and I'd like to think that he was just trying to be kind of innocent and naive. Let me tell you about my dreams. Yeah, I dreamt that we're all out in the wheat field and we're shocking up the wheat, and all of a sudden my wheat shock stands up and everybody else's bows down to mine. Okay, and if you have siblings, you know that doesn't go over well. That little punk kid saying you're gonna bow down. But then he says, oh, and then I dreamt about the sun, the moon, and the stars, and they all bowed down to me. Even Jacob or Israel was ticked off at that. We're bowing down to you. So of course you know that Joseph's brothers were so angry at him, so jealous of him, they wanted to kill him. Reuben said, hey, don't kill him, throw him in the pit. So they threw him in the pit. Reuben thought, okay, I'll come by later and pick him out of there. But before he could do that, they sold him off to Ishmaelite traders who were going down to Egypt. And they sold him to Potiphar, the king, or the captain of the guard for Pharaoh. About 13 years he worked there. And in that time, Joseph did well. He was a slave. It was not fun. But Joseph thought, okay, I gotta do this. I'm gonna make it good. And so he rose up, and pretty soon Potiphar had him in charge of everything. And all was good until Potiphar's wife got in the mix. And she thought, ooh, he's handsome. And she kept saying, come on. And he kept saying, no. And she'd say, come on. No, and again, and again, and again. And he's like, nope, nope, nope. But then one day, none of the other servants were around. It was just the two of them. And Mrs. Potiphar, come on. No, no. She grabbed a hold of his cloak. Joseph ran out of there without his cloak. And Mrs. Potiphar is thinking, all right, how can I get him? So she starts yelling for everybody to come. Come on, look at what this Hebrew did. My husband brought him in, and look at this. He tried to come on to me. Well, Potiphar came home that night, heard about it. And you kind of wonder, all right, Potiphar had been married all those years. He probably kind of knew about his wife. But on the other hand, that was his wife. This was his servant, his slave. And so he had Joseph, he became enraged, and he had Joseph thrown in jail. Now, even in jail, all right, this is not where you want someone to be, right? Unfairly accused, thrown in jail. Joseph thought, okay, I'm going to do what I can. And so he did what he could. And pretty soon the chief jailer is like, hey, this guy's good. And he pretty soon had the whole jail in charge, and the chief jailer never checked up on Joseph. And that's where our story ends for today. Come next week to find out what happens to Joseph. But there are a couple things I want to say about this today. What I noticed in the story is again and again and again, it talks about how the Lord was with Joseph. I mean, he ended up in the pit. He ended up as a slave in Egypt. He ended up in jail, falsely accused. I mean, these are horrible, horrible things that happened. And if we followed a prosperity gospel where, okay, if you just believe, everything good will be coming to you. And, you know, if you don't do good things, well, God must not be with you. We don't believe that. We don't believe that. We believe in a theology of the cross, that Christ comes to us in the midst of the depths of our grief and our pain, knowing our sin, knowing who we are. Christ comes to us. God comes to us. And on the cross, dies and has risen from the dead. And because of that, we are freed from sin, death, and the power of the devil. Not our doing. Not our doing, but Christ doing it for us. And so it's recognizing that, that it's not when these horrible things happen. As the writer of Ecclesiastes says, the rain falls on the just and on the unjust. Things happen to us. And just looking around, I know there are horrible things that happen. Some we cause, but many we don't. Many happen to us and we wonder why. How come? Michael was about 60 years old, and he was one of those really happy kind of guys. And people would come and say, how are you feeling today? And he'd say, I feel great. If I felt any better, I'd be twins. But he was one of those really happy Christians who pointed out that it was not him, but it was the grace of God, all the grace of God. And people would say, how can you be so happy? He said, well, it's all by the grace of God. But when I wake up every single morning, I think, okay, Michael, you have a choice. You can either relish in the grace of God and be happy, or you can wallow and be the victim. Why me? And he said, so every day I make that choice. Every day to recognize God, to recognize, but it's the grace of God. Years before, he had fallen 60 feet from a communications tower. And about 6 months after that, I mean, they did surgery for 18 hours on him. He had months of rehab, and when he left the hospital, he had rods all supporting his back. And about 6 months after that, one of his friends came and said, how are you doing? Heard about the accident. And he said, I feel great. If I felt any better, I'd be twins. And the guy said, no, really, how are you feeling? He said, really good. He said, so when you fell, what did you think? He said, when I came to on the ground, my immediate thought was my daughter who had not been born yet, and I wanted the best for her welfare. And then I thought, I've got a choice. I can either put my whole self in the hands of God, or I can just whine about things. And I thought, I need to put my hands and my whole body in God's care and trust God to bring me through. He said, when I got to the hospital, he said, that's when I really thought, okay, God, you've got to help me. He said, they wheeled me into the operating room, and I looked around, and I looked in the eyes of the doctors and nurses that were there, and they looked scared to death. They looked at me like I was a dead man. He said, there was this big burly nurse, and she was yelling at me all these instructions and asking me questions. And she finally said, I am allergic to anything. Allergic to anything. And he thought, I've got to do this. So he said, in a very loud voice, he said, yes, gravity. And he said, the doctors and nurses laughed. But then he said, please remember that as you are doing surgery, that I am alive and not dead. And do your best. And they did. I believe that Joseph had those same choices. He had these horrible things come at him, horrible things beyond his control. But he thought, how am I going to live? Am I going to live trusting in God to bring me through, to make sure that I get up each day, to give me the strength for the day? And God was with Joseph, even in the horrible times. Even when things looked so bleak, God was with him. And I believe that that is why, in the midst of things we cannot understand, Jesus comes to us and says, there is nothing in this world that's going to be able to separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. For he's got a hold of us and will never let us go. Amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Joseph was taken to Egypt in chains and sold, where he was bought by a captain named Potiphar.
I could retire in style.
And he did.
Oh, I did.
Joseph was an unimportant slave who found he liked his master. Consequently, worked much harder, even with devotion. Potiphar could see that Joseph was a cut above the average, made him leader of his household, maximum promotion.
Potiphar was cool and so fine, but my wife would never toe the line.
It's all there in chapter 39 of Genesis.
If you believe it,
she was beautiful but evil. Saw a lot of men against his will. He would have to tell her that she still was his.
You're mine!
Joseph's looks and handsome figure had attracted her attention. Every morning she would beckon,
come and lie with me, love.
Joseph wanted to resist her till one day she proved too eager. Joseph cried in vain, please stop, I don't believe in free love.
Pity.
Potiphar was counting shekels in his den below what he wanted. Gold would never make him happy if she didn't love him.
Please stand as you are able, as we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Rejoicing that Jesus is risen and love has triumphed over fear, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Be with us, Lord, throughout all our life. Grant your comfort and strength throughout the good times of our life, and especially when life is rough. Lord, in your mercy. From before the foundation of the world, you are God. Receive ecosystems destroyed by human greed. Curb our desire to put wealth ahead of the health of all who call this planet home. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of all, we pray for the nation and our leaders. We pray that we continue our course of freedom for all. Raise up all who are victims of marginalization, discrimination, and hate. Banish white supremacy and bigotry from the hearts of your people and remove the inclination towards anger and violence. Lord, in your mercy. God of justice, you reign in the steadfast love. Bring peace between nations ravaged by war or strife, especially in Gaza, Israel, and Ukraine. And illumine paths of justice and freedom from those who lead them. Lord, in your mercy. God of compassion, your touch brings healing and your word receives us for life. Hear our prayers for Pam, Dean, Bev, Sue, Joan, Karen, David, Kathy, Ed, Patty, Greg, Barbara, Judy, Bob, Kathy, Jess, Marion, Jim, Julie, Gigi, Antonio, Shelley, Jay, Amelia, Kevin, Don, Lori, Paul, and Mary Ellen, Ruth, Diana, Sherry, Dan, Laura, Ed, John, Ted, and those we name before you, either out loud or in the silence of our hearts. Turn wailing into dancing and weeping into joy. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, be with the family of Furnas Usman. Comfort them with the promise of resurrection. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O God, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in Jesus Christ, the spring of new and everlasting life. Amen.
You may be seated as we sing our hymn, As Saints of Old. Stand as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks and praise to our Lord, our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection has opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me. For as often as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we are reminded that Christ is present, who calls to us, gathers us, loves us, forgives us, and sends us out to love and care for one another. Let us join together in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated as we continue with the singing of Lamb of God. For those who are receiving communion in the pews, the body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Jesus, bread of life, we have received from your table more than we could ever ask. As you have nourished us in this meal, now strengthen us to love the world with your own life. In your name we pray. Amen.
Before the blessing, if you would like to stay for the annual meeting, you can leave after the sending. Or if you want to just stay in there, the meeting should start a little after 10. Receive the blessing. The blessing of God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us be upon you now and forever. Amen. Let us sing our final hymn, Go to the World.
Go in peace. You are the body of Christ.